shouted aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet.
Welcome to the 2016 National Day of Prayer Breakfast. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We come before you today with adoring and thankful hearts. We recognize that you are worthy of all honor and praise because you are God. You are the sovereign of the universe. You are the God of all providence. You provide for us everything that we need. You are the God with the power to forgive sins and to heal our land. We thank you for breaking the drought that was upon our land. Thank you, Father, for the abundant rain. Thank you for every precious drop of rain. We recognize at this very moment that you are the source of all of our blessings, and that you are the source of our strength. We also recognize that apart from you, we can do nothing. Gracious Father, we implore you, make your presence known to us in a mighty way. And just like you broke the drought that was upon our land, we pray that you would crush the spiritual drought that's plaguing our nation and the world. Father, we pray that you would awaken this nation. Revive us again, Heavenly Father. Set our hearts afire for our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, lay a burden upon our hearts for the lost. And give us the wisdom to reach this generation and the hearts of the next generation. We pray today in the mighty and precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we claim victory through his precious and holy shed blood. Amen. Amen. Good morning. My name is Julian Corpus, and I have the privilege of serving as the Vice President of the Ministerial Alliance this year. Our President, Mike McMahon, is not able to be with us this morning. He is overseeing the International Bible Reading Marathon at the gazebo on the square at this very moment. So he's not able to be here. But he sends his blessings through his devoted wife, Sandy, who is with us here this morning. Also, I would like everyone to know that immediately preceding the Bible reading marathon at the gazebo on the square, that there will be a brief praise and worship gathering followed by prayer, and everyone's invited, and that's going to be at noon. I would also like to give a special thanks to the City of Granbury and the Granbury Resort Conference Center. We are privileged to have with us today our city manager, Chris Kaufman, Assistant City Manager Sherry Campbell Husband, and our Mayor Nin Hewlett, and Conference Center Operations Manager Cleo Brown is around here somewhere too. Now, we express our deepest gratitude to these people, without whose help and support we would not be gathered here this morning. So we thank you for your faithful service to the Lord and to our community. Now, would you please stand and receive gratitude?
One more person I would like to give a special thank you to this morning. 8 years ago, Manette Sicard answered the call to organize a prayer breakfast. And so year after year, she has poured her heart and soul into this prayer breakfast. And I've had the privilege to work in tandem with her for the last several weeks, making sure this breakfast happens. And I can tell you, it's no small feat. So would you please join me in showing our appreciation for Manette Sicard.
In addition to honoring God on the National Day of Prayer today, we also want to thank God for our freedoms in this country, especially the freedom of assembly, speech, and of course, religion. Now, I would like to suggest to you this morning that there's a program on your table. Use the program, because the program is full and fast moving, and it'll be helpful to help you to follow along. And so everyone should have one. Also, if you will note on the back of the programs, there is a list of churches that will be open throughout Hood County and throughout the day. And we invite you to come within and pray in our churches. Amen? Amen. With that, I would like to turn it over to our good mayor, Nin Hewlett, who will lead us in the pledges and say a few words of proclamation.
Thank you. And I also want to thank everybody that puts this event together, because this is a great event. This is a good time to get together and fellowship with everyone. So thank you very much for putting this thing together. At this time, I'd like to have everybody join me in the pledge to the United States flag, followed by the pledge to the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the United States of America, and to the Republic from which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now the Texas flag. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible. As was stated, we have some proclamations, and I want to invite everyone to go out in the front lobby there. We have a proclamation from the city, the county, the state, and the USA. These are proclamations that have been presented to us. So if you would, exiting, stop by and take a look at those proclamations. At this time, I'd like to introduce Pastor Glenn Ward for our national prayer.
You have this on your table. It, I believe, will also be on the screen. This is a prayer that is being read all across the nation today. And we're thankful to join with our fellow citizens wherever they might be meeting this morning. So I will read the part says leader, and if you will read the part with people. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today as a humble people, yearning for your supernatural intervention on behalf of our beloved nation.
First, we thank you for all the blessings you have bestowed on our land, blessings that have allowed us to bring so much good and benefit to not only our citizens, but also to the rest of the world.
The very ideals upon which this country was founded were based on biblical truths.
It is for this reason that we repent and
Enable us by your Spirit to no longer be secret agent Christians, but rather to publicly declare and live out your truth in a spirit of love so that you feel welcome in our country once again.
Thank you for your promise to hear our prayers. We bring all to you with hearts of repentance and obedience.
On behalf of your church, we affirm afresh the priority you are to us.
We pray that you will fill every dimension of our lives and seek to bring your glory through the advancement of your kingdom and our personal lives, our family lives, and the lives of our churches and our government leaders.
We confidently invite heaven's intervention into all the affairs of our nation, and we praise you in advance for your answer.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Through times of, and please be seated, through times of war and peace, success and downturn, Americans have been a people of prayer, seeking God's guidance and giving thanks. Our forefathers blessed us with a heritage of coming together to pray as one people. In 1775, the Continental Congress asked the colonies to join in prayer, seeking wisdom as they faced the responsibility and opportunity of building a new nation. Years later, during a time of national turmoil, President John Adams declared a day of solemn humiliation, fasting, and prayer, and ask citizens of all faiths to pray for America's protection from danger. We should remember that from the earliest days of human habitation, this land we call Hood County has been a place of prayer. The Comanche peoples and other tribes, drawn here by the plentiful waters and far-reaching views from the top of the mesa we now call Comanche Peak, made the top of the mountain a sacred place, seeking to acknowledge the presence of the Creator as they knew him. the early Spanish explorers and priests coming upon the sweeping curves and bends of the river that carved this land were reminded of the encircling and loving arms of God and named it El Rio de los Brazos de Dios, the River of the Arms of God. The earliest settlers and pioneers who followed them brought their love of God and of His Son Jesus the Christ and of our nation with them. And their blood, toil, and sacrifice built here a community that 150 years later, this year, became known as Hood County. We who gather here today to pray for our nation and for our community are their heirs, beneficiaries of over a century and a half of prayer and witnessed by those who came before us. They shared the truth and the gift of God's unfailing love with us, and it is our charge to continue that legacy by proclaiming it to the next generation. It is in that hope that we shall share the truth with our children that Melinda Jo Ray has written a hymn as a gift to the people of Hood County, honoring the sacred memories of those who have served God in this place over the past 150 years, and as a pledge and exhortation that we continue to live lives that tell the story of God's encircling and redeeming love to each other and to our children and our children's children. A hymn of El Rio de los Brazos de Dios, sung today for the first time, is a prayer and a promise for all the beloved who dwell in the arms of God.
Forever ebb and flow.
Let me introduce to you the composer of that beautiful hymn, Melinda Jo Ray. Melinda, would you please stand? What a beautiful hymn. Thank you for adapting that. Thank you so much. I'd like to also introduce Christy Massey. Christy, where are you? Stand up, please. There you are. Yes, I want to thank Christy because of her service to our county. She is the president of the Hood County Historical Commission and also chair of the Hood County 150th Anniversary Committee. And we do appreciate so much, Christy, that you and Melinda also have done for our community. And thank you so much. And it's my pleasure and my honor to introduce the senator's much better half, Mel. The senator just happens to be working for us. Aren't we glad of that? Yes, he's in Austin working on border security issues, as I understand. But his beautiful, beloved, and much better half, Mel, is here to speak in his behalf.
Thanks, Rob. Thank you. Good morning. It is my honor and privilege today to pray for the truest heroes in our country, the law enforcement personnel, members of the United States Armed Forces, and for their precious families. There are many similarities between the two careers, but the most important one is that every day they go to work can be a dangerous day. Tragically, of late, our world has certainly turned a little upside down in respect to how we treat our law enforcement. We really got to do a lot to change that. But we did learn an important lesson in the way our troops returned from Vietnam. We learned how not to treat our troops when they come home. So we do a much better job of saying thank you to those who wear the uniform. We also need to learn to thank the families, the true unsung heroes that stand behind them every day. They're the single parents that act as both mom and dad when their spouse is deployed during multiple deployments. They're the rock for their kids when mom or dad are gone and miss those really major milestones in their lives. They move around the world, a lot of us know this, at a moment's notice, leaving behind everybody they know and love and start all over again. They're moms and dads whose children are serving in the military, and they worry night and day about the safety of their loved one who's deployed. And unfortunately, sometimes they do make the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. As Christians, it's our duty, as Scripture tells us in James 1:27, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after the widows and the orphans in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. So this morning, if you are a member of the law enforcement community, would you please stand so we can say thank you? If you have ever served in any branch of the military or are currently serving, would you please stand so we can recognize you? And last, but certainly not least, if you are a family member of either law enforcement or a military family member, would you please stand so we can thank you? I noticed the family members plopped down really fast because they're not used to being thanked for that. So would you join me in praying for these true heroes? Father God, we love you and we humbly come before you this morning to lift up the bravest among us, our law enforcement personnel, members of the military, and their truly brave families. We thank you for the blessing our community has with so many shiny examples of true heroes. And Lord, we thank you for the safety they provide us that we may sleep soundly at night and for the freedom they fight to defend with their very own lives. I want to especially lift up the families of both of those groups. There's no greater sacrifices made than those families who watch the ones they love selflessly doing their jobs at the peril of their own lives so that we are safe and free. Keep us ever mindful of our duty to the families who have given the last full measure of devotion that we may never forget to care for them. Thank you for the showers of loving kindness and protection that you give us all moment by moment because your word clearly tells us that all lives matter. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Good morning. Thank you for letting me join you on your National Prayer Day at breakfast. I appreciate getting to join you this way and apologize for not being there in person. As we focus our nation on God and the blessings that He's bestowed upon us, I think it's incumbent on us to take stock, quite frankly, of what about this country is blessable. In other words, put yourself in God's perspective as He looks at our country. What's going on that does, in fact, worthy of His blessings? Are we asking God to bless the deterioration of the family unit and the impact that has on the moral compasses of children? We're asking Him to bless the coursing of our society, the way we interact with each other, the language that gets used, and the stuff that comes out of Hollywood that goes for entertainment, the way we aggrandize and in many instances deify the people who put that on. And can we really ask God to bless the killing of 57 million babies in the last 43 years? That's twice the population of Texas, plus 5 million babies in addition to that. These and other things God cannot and will not bless. And so as we look at our country, it's getting more and more difficult for God to bless it. John Adams wrote that our form of government, our self-governance scheme, is only suitable for moral and religious people. I'm hard-pressed to argue that we are maintaining that moral high ground, that moral authority that will allow us to self-govern. So in addition to asking what God should bless, we really need to ask ourselves, what should we do to try to reclaim that moral high ground? Where do we plug in to begin to sew back together that tattered moral fabric that has allowed us to self-govern for some 240 years? Each of us has a code that we live by. I live by the Judeo-Christian model. Jesus Christ is my personal Savior, and I try to live His tenets every single day, and you know, some days I'm better at it than others. But you've got a code that you have to live by as well. You, your family, your neighborhood, community, city, state, all of us have concentric rings of influence where every day we've got to be about that hard, arduous task of pushing back against the evil, speaking out for good and the worthy of this world and this country. It will not come without a price. It may have been that way the last several years, but from this point forward, we will be challenged, and it will come at a cost for you to stand up for your faith, stand up for your beliefs in love, and challenge those folks who make decisions that we disagree with. And so as we look at this issue, it's vitally important that we get started on it today. It's clearly important for the last 100 years that we've been in been in this world where America has done more for the rest of the world than any other country. But looking at the next 100 years, who's going to be that protector of freedom and that defender of the liberty and the weak if it's not us? Russia, China, radical Islam. If it's not us, then whom? And so as we look at this issue, though, God can't use a country that's not blessable in that role. He didn't use the nation of Israel in the Old Testament. When their hearts were not right with Him, He couldn't use them for the mission he had selected, His own chosen people. And so if liberty and freedom are to be defended for the next 100 years, if this self-governance scheme that we love and that have grown up in is to be extended, then we've got to be that moral people. We've had to have that moral authority and that moral self-governance that allows us to protect those God-given rights of freedom and liberty that come so dear to all of us. Again, thank you for letting me be with you this morning. Think about what your role personally is for reclaiming that moral high ground. Please join me in a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the multitude of blessings you've bestowed upon this country, many of them undeserved, but we certainly appreciate them, Lord. Lord, we appreciate the men and women who have such a heart for this country that they would put on our uniforms and defend this country, sometimes with their lives and in many instances with their bodies. Thank you for that dedication to country. Lord, we ask that all of us would have that spirit about us, that we want to do those things that would extend this self-governance scheme by being that moral people who can in fact self-govern. Help us, Lord, to be worthy of those blessings. Help us also understand that it comes with that responsibility will no longer be as easy as it may have been in the past, and that we will get challenged. We thank you for those challenges, Lord. Now, Lord, bless this food on earth for our bodies at your service. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Congressman Conaway's assistant, Diane Williams, is with us here today. I think we ought to acknowledge her. She's very, very supportive of everything we do in Granbury. We very much appreciate you. How many of you would like to be 13 years old again? Raise your hand if you'd like to be 13 years old again. Now, it's very, very select few. For the select few that would like to be 13 years old again, there is a catch. If you choose to roll the clock back and be 13 again, that means we are going to return you to middle school. For some of us, it was called junior high back in those days. We're going to send you back to a junior high building. And few of you want to be 13 years old again because you recall what junior high or middle school was like. Middle school is a time of unprecedented change in a child's life. Relationships with peers change and change very, very rapidly. In-groups are formed as well as out-groups. It's a time of identity formation, and it's also a time of faith development as well. And furthermore, it's a time when kids just have the potential to be downright mean and cruel to each other. So I suspect, I could be wrong, but I suspect that's why very few of you care to be 13 years old again. In some ways, in today's culture, nothing has changed, because human nature has remained fundamentally unchanged. So nothing has changed, but in other ways, everything has changed. For our middle school students that will start classes here in just a few moments, social media is an integral part of their existence. So there's Instagram, and there is Twitter, and there's Snapchat, and there's Kick, and Voxer, and there's even old school texting as well. Our 13-year-olds would tell us that Facebook is for old people. My 19-year-old informed me of that fact last year. And those of you who choose to communicate via email, I hate to break the news, you are downright ancient, without a doubt. Not much time this morning to delve in to all the pitfalls and all the dynamics that are created as a result of social media, but I will say this. Social media takes everything that a 13-year-old, or even a 16-year-old, for that matter, normally experiences, and then in turn multiply that by 1,000. So you think about all those identity issues, all those things that create fear in their lives, all those things that are really, really stressful. Just take all those things and multiply it by 1,000. And that's what their experience. And that makes you really not want to return, because that's what members of Generation Z, as they are called, will experience today. So consequently, they need empathy. They need authentic, genuine Christians of all ages who choose to love them, who choose to learn their language, who choose to consciously enter their culture and their world. Perhaps who even choose to download Instagram. I want this morning to welcome from Crossland Ninth Grade Center, Chris Willis, one of our own students, who will pray and pray in this regard.
God, I thank you for bringing everyone here this morning, and I just ask you to bless everyone in this room. And I ask you to send out the older generations today, God, and I ask you just to let them be a blessing to my generation, to the younger generations, God, and just be able to teach us how to love you, God, and just to be with you. Just be able to teach your word, and just to be able to go out in our community and just be able to talk about you freely and openly, God. And I just ask you just to be with us everywhere we go. Amen. And now I would like to introduce Ms. Spencer.
Christopher is one of the students that I get to work with at Crossland Ninth Grade Center. And isn't that wonderful that he presents hope to pray for us? You know, just a few days ago, Christopher's always excited about talking about Jesus. He amazes me. And you know, he lets the light shine of who Christ is to other kids. He's a great student at our campus. We really are appreciative of Crossland Ninth Grade Center. However, this year it will dissolve and become a new part of Crossland Ninth Grade Wing at Granbury High School. It's been amazing to work at Crossland Ninth Grade Center. I have a wonderful privilege today to honor our school's namesake, Mrs. Wanda Crossland. Mrs. Crossland, will you please stand and just wave at us? Thank you. Wanda served in the public schools for 36 years. 30 of those years were in Granbury, Texas. She and her late husband, Willie Crossland, together gave 70 years of their lives as educators in our public schools. You see, every time I see Wanda out in the public, she says, "How's my James?" She doesn't say, "Hi, Kim, how are you?" She just says, "How's my little James?" You see, little James was a second grade student in Wanda's class whenever he was a little 8-year-old boy. But what she probably really knew and understood that that was a tough year for him. That was the year that James's mother left their family because she was suffering from a mental condition. So James would go home at night with two other siblings, and there was a single father there, and they were trying to make life work. That was the same year that James suffered a hearing loss condition. It was a hard year for him. It was a setback for him. But you know what? Mrs. Crossland noticed. She noticed, and she gave him that extra needed love and care during his second grade year. You see, James is the man that I've been married to for 33 years. He remembers how kind you were to him and that you lived a life sacrificing for children. Thank you for loving children. Thank you for being the salt and light of Jesus Christ in the hearts of generations of young people. James Spencer and I, and I'm sure many others, are grateful to God for the dedication you and Willie Crossland both gave of your lives. You see, James and I are especially grateful because we both come from broken homes. My father was an alcoholic. My parents were divorced, and I had been abused as a child. Families and young people are in distress more than they ever have been. Suicide, suicide attempts, self-harm, which kids call cutting, has risen as much as 250% in the last 5 years among our young people nationwide. Our kids need hope. I took it upon myself a few days ago to ask some of our kids, if you wanted to say something to the older generation that you want them to hear, what would you say? And over, I heard them say, "Tell them to talk to me. Tell them to spend time with me." People, we need to connect with our young people. We need to look them in the eyes. We need to spend time with them. We need to be the salt and light of Jesus Christ in their lives. If you just took a few minutes and you thought about who God puts on your heart to go and talk to, tell them you love them. Tell them you love them by your actions. Model who Christ is to them. Just last week, I had a counselor intern in my office, Miss Lauren Dunn, who is here this morning, and her husband, Brian. Lauren comes by occasionally, and we'll talk about the resources that are out there for kids in the counseling world. And she and I have gotten the opportunity to kind of get to know each other. And we have shared our childhood stories, and we are amazed and grateful to God that He has taken our broken lives as children and used them for His purposes. So we have, because Lauren took the time to tell her story to an organization, we have a video. And so we would like to show that to you this morning. And Lauren and Brian, if you would just step up here and we'll show that video.
What an honor it is to be able to share Lauren's story, our story. It's all God's story of redemption and healing. And it's been an honor to be married to Lauren and see her walk humbly and take that step. And it just reminds me how important it is right now in this time. We've got to share the love of Christ with people, no matter who it is. We've got to be bold in our faith, and we're going to have to really be there for each other. But we're going to have to start getting really intense about getting the love of Christ out there and sharing who He is. Not just His love, but people's need for forgiveness, and that He is the only name given to us for which a man or a woman can be saved. That's what God's Word says, right? So let me pray for us and for God to give us that strength to do that. Father in heaven, we just come before You in the authority of Jesus' name. We thank you that you're the God that brings strength and healing, brings us from brokenness to redemption and healing. You are the God of all things. We exalt you. Lift your name high. Give us boldness to go before people that we work with, go to the gym with, serve with, Lord God, to share who you are and what you've done for us on the cross. Give us strength and intensify our faith to be there for one another, to stand together, and whatever forces may come against us, that we would stay firm and true and our eyes lifted up to you no matter what. And I pray this over our community and everyone here. We all say, amen.
In a very respectful, honorable way, we'd like to acknowledge that we've had kids that didn't make it. In our county, we know for a fact. And so, Mrs. Julia Pinnell, by the ringing of the bell, will honor the children, the 11 children we know that have not.
Oh, how beautiful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, how can we make a difference? How can we wake up America? How are we going to reach the hearts of the next generation? There is hope for this country. If we reach out to these children today with the gospel, you know, the children are 100% of our future. I want you to look at these figures here that show children in the United States on based on Barna research. 85% of all Christians make a decision for Christ between the ages of 4 and 14. Now, you all may relate to this, and I would like to see a show of hands of those that received Christ as Savior between the ages of 4 and 14. Now, that looks like 85% of the room. Okay, let's look at if you received Christ between the ages of 15 and 30. Please raise your hands. Okay. And now, if you were 30 or older when you received Christ, please raise your hand. Hands. Okay. That shows true. I like to do that every time because the statistics show that. Well, Barna research also shows that 80% of American children have never set foot in a church. That's 8 out of 10 children in our country that have never set foot in a church. So we have to assume that at home they are not being trained up the way they should go and by the instruction of the Lord. The focus now on missionary strategy is children 4 to 14. Lewis Bush, missionary strategist, is the one that came up with the 1040 geographic window. Well, he has now coined the phrase 414. That's the missionary strategy today. And the newly found faith of a child can change the whole family. Child Evangelism Fellowship, which is who I work for, is a program, they have a program called the Good News Club. And this is a wonderful way to reach children in this age group. Now we get to do it in the public schools. So we also do other locations in communities and all over the United States and in 196 countries. So Good News Clubs are little Bible clubs that meet in the elementary schools and the communities after school for about an hour. Many, many unchurched parents give permission for the children to attend these Good News Clubs. So the children, they get to hear the good news of Jesus Christ, and our teachers encourage moral Christian behavior through trained and screened workers through CEF. Now, over the last 79 years since CEF has been in existence, there have been countless testimonies, countless stories of how children and their families have changed and come to Christ. And one is right here in Acton Good News Club at Acton Elementary School. A little girl came to know Christ through her Good News Club. She went home, told her family. They all started going to church. They all got saved. They all got baptized, and they are active members at the sponsoring church, Acton Baptist Church. It's awesome. So what is God doing here in Hood County? He's doing a lot. Do you know that there is a Good News Club in every elementary school in Hood County? Every single one of them. There's other locations too, but we get to be in the public school. Since 2001, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that religious organizations could meet in public schools just like any other organization. That's how God opened the door for us to reach these children. You're going to find on your table a sheet that looks like that up on the screen. And at this time, I'd like for you to gather at your tables and pray. And just pray for these clubs, the churches, the schools, and how wonderful this county is that we live in. And pray that more children will be able to attend these good news clubs that you see there on your table. So if you just take a few minutes and do that at this time. Dear Lord, we just want to say thank you for the privilege of telling your children about Jesus in these good news clubs, and we pray right now that you would keep these doors open and provide more and more laborers for the harvest until your return. We thank you for hearing our prayers this morning, and we're praying in accordance with your will that not one little one would perish. We love you, dear Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. A few of our kids here, Good News Club kids, would like to sing one of their songs to you. Okay, so these kids are going to stay standing on the stage, and at this time, we would like anybody else in the room that is 18 years or younger to stand up too. Okay, stay up there. Because we want to pray, all of us in the room would like to pray for you all, a very special prayer based on Luke 2:52. So if y'all would join me in this prayer, and if you're close to a child, go ahead and lay hands on them. If you're close to them, put your hand on their shoulder, and let's pray this prayer together. May these young people grow in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Okay, the picture. Where's the picture? There we go. This little man right here in the picture is here this morning, Hudson. Where's Hudson? Hudson, where are you? Hey. And we want to acknowledge you because you're an example of reaching out to the youngest possible age for Christ. So thank you.
Thank you. Take a look around at the people all around you. and realize that those people at the tables standing around the room, we are the body of Christ. And as the body of Christ, we have a responsibility, a sacred responsibility given to us by God. In Matthew, Jesus gave this charge, this warning to his followers. He says, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depths of the sea." Perhaps the most damaging thing anyone can do to lead a child astray as the body of Christ is not any action we take or anything we say, but the things that we don't say, the things that we don't do. As the body of Christ, it is our silence that can be the most damaging. To see a wound and to know that a word of encouragement, that an expression of God's love can make all the difference, and to not give it. The generation, they've been wounded and broken. And as the body of Christ, we have a responsibility. We look around and we say, families are broken. The world has failed them. I can't blame the secular world for being secular. It is the responsibility of the body of Christ, the people of God, to stand up where the secular world has failed. It is our responsibility. Where there isn't a parental figure in their lives to be that mentor. It doesn't take much. It doesn't take a program. There, if you're ever wondering, how can I get started? What can I do? Out in the foyer, we have a table with several resources here in the community that can help you get started. These are amazing resources that are working day in and day out on reaching children. But the simple fact of the matter is, it doesn't take a program, it doesn't take a huge plan, it doesn't take an organization. It takes a single person looking around at the lives of people around them and taking the time to listen. Just to listen. Listening to a person speaks more value and truth into their life than anything else. Just take 30 minutes out of your day and say, "You are important enough for me to hear your story, to listen to your pain." As the body of Christ, this is our responsibility. Let me encourage you in this time to look around with those sitting with you at your tables and just go to God and ask Him to give you a vision to reach the lives of the young people that He has placed in your lives today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are your hands, we are your feet. We are your manifestation here in this world. Lord, break our hearts. Please send your people, because the needs are many and the workers are few. Open our eyes to the possibilities, to all the needs around us. And help us to boldly take action as this is what you've called us to do. It is in your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let me acknowledge real fast, there are those in our community who are already making a difference, who are already touching lives all around us. There are some here from Teen Mad who are already making a huge difference in the substance abuse in the generation, in our schools. And we want to remember that they are already making a difference in their own generation. As we enter into our benediction, we're going to ask you to join us as we sing Let There Be Peace on Earth. And afterwards, if you need to go as the benediction is being, are we doing, as the benediction is being sung, then we'll please go and do that.
Amen. As we sing this final benediction, we understand there are people that do need to leave, and if you need to leave, you are dismissed as we sing this benediction at the name of Jesus. Go forth in the spirit of the day. Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you peace. Go out and make a difference in the world today.